Hello friends, good afternoon and welcome to Reset Live Lectures. Dear friends, as you know that we started a series on religion, culture and society in Indian history, and today we are conducting yet another lecture in the same series. In today's lecture, we will try to understand temples as sites of Brahmanical religion in early India. To discuss this topic, we have with us our subject expert, Mr. Saurabh Kumar. Mr. Saurabh Kumar is a gold medalist in MA History. He also has won Teaching Excellence Award by Vice Chancellors of Delhi University. He has over 4 years of teaching experience and he has been associated with Delhi University. Without further ado, I would like to welcome sir to our studios and request him to start the lecture. Welcome sir.
Hello everyone. As we are aware, this lecture is a part of a larger series which is known as Religion, Society and Culture in Indian History. So, keeping in touch with that same series, today I will be discussing as temples as sites of Brahmanical religion. And this lecture has been divided into two parts. In the first part, we will discuss temples as sites. And in the second part, we will discuss temples as structures of Brahmanical religion. Now, before we proceed further, let's discuss some basic things here. First of all, this lecture is in continuation, so we should understand that religion or even Brahmanic religion was a part of larger picture which can be termed as culture. And since culture is very much a part of history, so religion undoubtedly falls into the ambit of historical studies. So a historian has every right to discuss about religion. That's what I'm emphasizing here. Now then, secondly, we'll be discussing sources of this period. So as far as temples are concerned or religion is concerned, so we'll be looking into the sources which are of two types, primary and secondary. Most of these sources are religious sources. Literary sources happen to be religious, but then there are certain inscriptions which we find on temple walls, copper plate charters which record the grant of lands for these temple construction. Then at times donor inscriptions are there, where people who had certain socio-economic status have donated according to their capacities for the upkeep and maintenance of these religious shrines and structures. Now, as far as geographical spread of these temples is concerned, it's quite interesting to note that there has always been an overlap of space, and there is a great differentiation of time and space when we talk of religious structures. So that warrants some great discussion, which we'll do in the coming slides. Next is historiography of this period. But when we talk of historiography, that little bit of discussion on geography is essential here. We are talking of entire Indian subcontinent, and we are focusing on these shrines and these sites which were built across different times across the entire subcontinent. Now, when we talk of historiography, as we all are aware, there were many trends of historiographical traditions, predominantly being the imperialist and the nationalist in the colonial period. After that, we have Marxist historiography, and then we have processual as well. Now, if we emphasize on the dominant historiographical traditions, we find that the imperialist historiography or the nationalist historiography did not emphasize much on these temple structures. In fact, the art and architectural aspects of these temples were subdued or rather taken as the extra paths of the political history. Such was the trend of history writing in those days. Now, gradually in the 70s onwards, we find that art history develops as a separate domain. And lots of detailed studies were done on all these temple structures. There are many scholars who have worked on it. For example, we can take the name of Percy Brown, A.K. Kumar Swami. We can talk of many more scholars. And in recent times, we have Parul Pandeyadhar talking about Toran structures in India and Southeast Asian temples. So thus, we find that there is no dearth of scholars. Now, scholars like R.S. Sharma and Vidya Dahejia, they speak of temples and they look into the contemporary feudal social structures which get reflected through these temples. So, as they say, these discussions are like something which make the entire discussion on temples quite interesting and happening. Next, we should discuss what is the concept of a temple and what's the concept of Brahmanism. So, first, let's discuss what is Brahmanism. When we talk of Brahmanic religion, we are talking of the dominant religious idea which was prevalent in Indian subcontinent right since Bronze Ages. Now, there is a debate here in this issue. Instead of talking of Hinduism, it's preferably we should talk of Brahmanism, because in the case of Brahmanism, we can include the Bronze Age societies as well and all the cultures from there. In fact, we can connect it directly to the Vedic religious ideas and the dominant status which Brahmins had as a social category. But the term Hindu is a later construct. That's why just for the sake of academic convenience, we are talking of Brahmanic religion. Secondly, temples. What are temples? We all must have seen temples here and there in all our surroundings. But the idea of a temple as a historical category of study is quite interesting. It comes from the idea of a sacred space, a demarcated space, which has been provided some sanctity either by the contemporary society or based on a tradition. No one doubts this sanctity. In fact, it is accepted and goes unchallenged. If we remember about the last lecture where we discussed about renunciatory traditions, we find that non-conformity to the society gives birth to renunciation. In fact, it's taken as a challenge to the dominant structures. In the same way, when we look at temples as sites, we can take them as separate demarcated areas which are untouched by the settled population but still venerated and respected by them. These different sites also underwent large-scale differentiation as time passes, and we find that even these sites have a very heterogeneous follower base. Not all the sites enjoy the same level of veneration or respect. So this is something we should keep in mind before beginning the lecture. Next, we find the concept of changing continuities. If we look at temples only, if we focus only at temples, we find that there is a great deal of change coming up in their structure, the way they are constructed, the way they are projected, the way they develop, the way they are renovated as well. Most of the times we find religious structures do get renovated. Now, at every time when renovation takes place, we find that the older ideas get transformed and more modernity comes into place. So, with these basic premises, I wish to develop my arguments here and discuss this lecture with you. Hope you find it interesting here. Now, we move on to the idea of association of temples with Brahmanism. As already discussed, concept of Brahmanism is an umbrella term, and it has always taken it quite in a very benevolent way, in a very easy way, appropriation of the earlier cults practices, and thus we say it's of an assimilatory nature. Well, all the diversities have got incorporated together and then given it a nature of an umbrella like religion. Instead of calling it religion, we can also call it a way of living, where we find that ideas or religious ideas like Buddhism, Jainism or even Ajiviks, they found a place in the dominant Brahmanic religion as time passes by. And a good example of this is that Buddha and Mahavir have always been mentioned as an incarnation of Vishnu. Though this idea of incarnation is quite recent in the sense that it develops with the Gupta period Puranic ideas. But still we find that this is how assimilation happens. Then we can call it a negotiation or a contestation which is happening in a very assimilatory manner. Now, when we talk of sacred space or shrines, let's begin this discussion right since the Stone Ages. As we all are aware, Indian subcontinent has a history which begins from the Stone Ages. These periods are known as prehistoric periods, then we find protohistoric periods and then historic periods. So, even in prehistoric periods, when we don't find literate societies, we do find the concept of sacred space. For example, Upper Paleolithic, we find certain cult objects like mother goddess figurines, which are generally termed as Venus figurines. Then we have different cult sites. For example, the idea of burials, that's even taken as the cult of the dead. Then we find ideas of using flowers, using certain mounds as mother goddess shrines. As this thing moves on, we go on to the Bronze Age. We find that nice developments happen there, complexities come up, refinements take place and sophistications in the religious sphere could be seen. We all are aware of the Shiv Pashupati seal concept during Harappan civilization or the mother goddess images. Now that Pashupati seal is another debatable issue, but just for the sake of convenience, we can say that they reflected their certain ideological aspects. As we proceed further, we come to the Vedic age. When we talk of Vedic age, we find that the religious sphere is again greatly transformed. We find yajñas playing a crucial role there, and we find dominance of a particular social category which served as the guardian-like entity for all the religious activities in those days. Now, after this, when we proceed further, we can talk of differentiation of space and time in context of religion and religious ideas. Here, I would like to give certain illustrations. When we talk of differentiation of time, we all would be aware of the concept of Kumbh, how the nectar drops fell at four different places. And we can take the name of Prayag, Ujjain, Haridwar and Nasik, where this concept of Mahakumbh happens. Historically speaking, it has a Puranic background. So if we say that concept of Kumbh has a Puranic background, we can safely place it with the Gupta period onwards. Now in the same context, when we proceed further and we find Shankaracharya towards the early medieval period talks of four dham concept or the char dham concept. And these dhams are made the cardinal points in the entire subcontinent. Now here we find quite interestingly that the space, the sacred space concept has expanded from the earlier Mahakumbh areas, from the earlier Kumbh areas, we are now moving on to the larger areas. For example, Badrinath, Puri, Dwarka and then Rameshwaram. Now this and in deep south we find that these four cardinal points mark the sacred space and then areas inside. Now in the same way we find the 12 Jyotirlings or the 12 sites held sacred in Shaivite traditions, and then we find the Shaktipeets, sites which are associated with Durga or Shakti cults. Now here if we emphasize into this or we go into details, we find that Shaktipeets have a background. They are mentioned that when different body parts of Sati fell in different places and then these sites developed as centers of religious veneration. Now what I would emphasize here, that this shows that how with the passage of time, these different sites which may or may not would have been into existence earlier became popularized and they were all connected through a common story or a common tradition which is mentioned in Puranic religious ideas. Now here the concept of Sati can be taken as that thread which binds together all these diverse sites, giving it a very nice integrative structure. This integration is something which a historian should focus upon, or a student of history should try to understand why this integration came into existence and how it got popularized. Similarly, when we look at the literature of early medieval period, now in this period we find that literature has a tendency of charit literature known as biography. On one hand, we find that royal personalities got their biographies penned down by patronizing scholars. At the same time, we find texts like Kritya Kalptaru written by Bhatt Lakshmidhar under Garhwal patronage. There is a section in the in this text known as Tirth Vivechan, which talks of the networks of Tirthas during early medieval period. Now, early medieval period is generally placed as 600 to 1200 CE. Now, thus these are the examples how with the passage of time, the sacred space also transforms itself and the society assimilates this transformation in a very positive manner. Now, so I hope this discussion here has a easy understanding for all of you. So let's proceed further with this idea. Temples in Indian society have a larger role to play. When we ask a layman, he would say that no, these are simple structures where religious activities are done. But for a student of history, a temple is not only a religious structure, it has a larger role. And now what are these larger roles? Now we should look into these temples from a very neutral angle. First of all, these temples are a good symbol of how technological improvements have taken place over the passage of time. In the slides, you will find that certain Gupta period temples are discussed where we have a flat roof. Gradually, there is a shikhar-like concept. Now, if we connect these ideas to present times, earlier they were using mortar, brick or stone. Nowadays, we are using cement, we are using marble, we are using lots of ready-made structures. So, when we connect this past tradition of temple building to present, we can easily make a trajectory of technological growth and we can understand how in a simple structure, we can mark how different technological changes has come up. No doubt the structures are not demolished every time. They're simply renovated. So with a keen observation, we can bring out how those transformations have taken place and what all technological changes happened over there. Now, when we talk of historical aspects, we say that most of these temples were agencies of political legitimization. This is something which we should understand. Political legitimization means kings or leading political personalities patronized the construction of these temples, and after construction they used it to legitimize their power, legitimize their authority or to win a larger social, to win the mass support. Famous examples here would be the Jagannath Puri structures and how the kings used in Odisan case, or the concept of Ek Lingji in Mewar and how the local kings used over there. Now, amongst all these examples, I would like to emphasize more on the concept of Brihadishwar temple in Tanjore, in deep south, and how the Chola emperors used this concept. So thus we say temples are also a source of political legitimization. Leading monarchs of the day, they patronized these temples, they renovated these temples so as to gain a larger support amongst the masses. When we talk of modern period onwards, we do find that there was a stupa made in Sanchi, which was predominantly associated with, is predominantly associated with modern age. Shunga dynasty, which comes after modern dynasty, it undertook that renovation project and renovated that Sanchi stupa. So thus we say that how these structures are also a source of political legitimization. Now we find that these are means of dissemination of cultural ideas. What do cultural ideas mean? Culture largely includes art forms, dance forms, folk tales, puppet shows, etc. In the premises of these temples, you can find that all these cultural happenings, kirtans, bhajans, for example, all these traditions can get easily incorporated and they find a very beautiful place for themselves. This temple provides a nike or a place for all these diverse activities which have a historical background or a cultural background. Similarly, when we talk of early medieval period temples, we find that dance forms like Bharatnatyam, it developed in the temple premises. Kings patronized these dance forms and the Devdasis, for example. Now please, I am very careful here, I am not saying the practice was good, but the Devdasis, which were associated with different temples, they popularized these dance forms more than any other agency. Similarly, the ornament making tradition, the dress making tradition, or even the prasad making tradition. Prasad is like that food offering which is generally offered to the deity. All these things can be taken as different cultural attributes associated with a temple. Then as we proceed further, temples are examples of cult syncretization, how different cults came together and how in larger run they started having a nice negotiable position for themselves or an integration-like situation. Another illustration would be in point here. We talk of Shiv Parivar or the family of Shiv. Shiv married to Parvati, having children like Ganesh and Kartike. But when we look into the historicity of these different deities, we find that they were great deities in their own time and space context. Shiv having a pan-Indian personality, Parvati having a identity in hilly areas or predominantly in eastern parts of the subcontinent, Ganesh in peninsular parts and Kartike in deep south. So when we find that the concept of syncretization happens, that these different cults also come together. Now, if we delve deep into this discussion, we find that they have Vahan concept. Vahan like having vehicles, Shiv having Nandi, Parvati having lion, Ganesh having a rat, and similarly Kartike or Murugan having a peacock. These different animals would also be associated with some of the other dominant cult in different places. As these different deities came together, thus their vehicles also come together and we find a larger picture of a religious idea covering almost the entire subcontinent. These ideas develop from Gupta period onwards when we find Puranic ideas getting popularized and people accepting them or people starting believing in such things. And then even kings like Samudragupta, for example, who started ruling the entire subcontinent, these extension of political ideas would have also emphasized on such ideas and even popularized that thus deities coming together would have promoted political harmony or it would have helped the king on throne as well. Now, as we move ahead, we find that temples also reflect upward social mobility. In Indian case, we find, historically speaking, there were certain classes which enjoyed economic upward mobility but were denied upward social mobility. Now, in these cases, these classes patronized certain temple structures so that they could enjoy some or the other social status. Two case point can be taken here. First example I would take that the Guild of Ivory Workers renovated the gateways of Sanchi Stupa. Secondly, we find that a guild of silk weavers in Mansoor area, they renovated a famous, they in fact got constructed a famous Shiv temple in that area. Now, here I would say that what made these guilds to invest into such activities? Somewhere it would not only be religious idea, it would also be some other ideas, some other benefits which they would be drawing from it. It might be taken as a USP-like idea or popularizing their identity, something like sponsoring or something like advertising their existence. Now, this was a very easy example here. As we proceed further, we find that women are very active donors in most of the religious bodies. What made these women to donate there? Interestingly, in most of the cases when they make donations, their names are not written. In fact, they are mentioned as daughters of so-and-so or wives of so-and-so or mothers of so-and-so. Now, instead of going into detail of this gendered perspective here, I would just try to incorporate this idea of discussion that what made women to donate into these structures. Thus, we can find that even this donation had a nice social background to it. It was not only to earn religious merit. No doubt, religious merit predominantly makes a background to all such activities. But there has to be some other identity-related issues which we should discuss and which we should understand. Then we find that temples are examples of extension of socio-political frontiers. A king wins over an area, for example. So what the king would do to the already existing temple structures there? Instead of demolishing there, the king would try to stamp those structures with his own political identities so that in the larger run, people start identifying that king with that same structure. We are aware of many wars which happened between different dynasties and how they started treating the religious structures or shrines in the territories of their enemies. Then we find patterns of patronage. This is something again quite interesting. Scholars like Romila Thapar, they have talked on the tradition of patronage which took place during early India. Patronage is something which is quite varied and it cannot be taken as a blanket concept. It has a good background to it. The idea of patronage can be talked of from Ashokan times itself. Ashok patronized Buddhism in a very active manner. After that, we find Buddhism enjoys royal patronage every now and then. In the last lecture also, we discussed the causes of decline of Jainism and Buddhism, where we talked of royal patronage associated with Buddhism. During Satvahan times, we find that on one hand, the Satvahan inscriptions say that the kings on throne are patronizing Brahmanic ideas. They are prohibiting Varna Samkar, that is intermixing of the Varnas. While on the other hand, we find the queens of Satvahanas are actively patronizing Buddhist and Jain monks. Now, why this happens? Again, we can look into the social issues here. We can explain it easily that since there were diverse elements present in the society, thus royalty was bound to patronize these sects so as to promote social harmony. It's something we can look into, like in present context, we can look into something like vote bank politics, but that would give it a very mean look. But in short, we can say that it was something like patronizing all the diverse sects here, all the diverse believers here, so as to reach a well-negotiable or a peaceful social scenario. Then we proceed further. The temples reflect social norms, existing social norms. This is something very interesting when we look at these temples from a very artistic point of view. These temples not only reflect the technological improvements, but on their walls we can find lots of decorations, sculptures. Most of the times these sculptures are erotic sculptures. Now, when I talk of erotic sculptures, the places like Khajuraho temples easily come to mind. Won't we find fascinating that why kings got erotic sculptures displayed on these temples? Today, such structures are treated as a taboo or such shrines, or in fact, they would be branded as porn today in present circumstances. But it's quite fascinating that in 11th, 12th century, during early medieval times, kings got these sculptures which are truly based on Kama Sutra, which are truly based on erotic ideas, and very actively they are depicted on most of the temple walls. So this is something again which shows that how contemporary society looked into these issues and how it wanted to project these, or how it wanted the later generations to perceive it. These can be known as self-images of these contemporary societies. So thus, in this sense, temples are again a source of information for those societies. Then we find that temples develop a certain locality, differentiate that space, and they mark the trajectory of growth of that space or transformation of that space from an unknown place to a major urban center, a major marketplace, and sometimes even into a major political center. Most of the places in Indian subcontinent are known by the famous temples which were either built in that place or in the vicinity of that place. Kashi, for example, is known as a temple town. So thus we find that a place Kashi is an urban center. It has been an urban center. Thus, a place draws its identity through a temple-like structure. Then we find employment generation. Now, this is something very easy to understand. A huge, massive temple complex can easily generate income opportunities for a large section of the population. Now, we find that sometimes there is a change in the nature and identity of the temple structure as well. For example, the famous temple at Gaya, it has actively been associated with Buddhist traditions, Shaiv traditions, and even Vaishnav traditions. So thus we find that the same site can be actually associated with diverse ideas. Now we find phases of development. Sacred groves of prehistoric periods transform themselves into stupa-like structures, then from their cave structures, monasteries, chaityas and viharas of Buddhist and Jain ideas, and finally into Gupta period temple structures. Then we find these temple structures in the longer and develop into distinct identities of their own, giving birth to regional ideas, regional styles, and these regional styles in their own right have different sub-regional styles. So we find in this slide the cave architecture of modern period. We can see that these caves in Barabar Hills, they are actually built hewn out of a rock surface, but they are looking into the architecture is exactly like a wooden architecture. Then here in this slide, we can look into the stupa architecture. This stupa architecture in the long run gets transformed into a temple architecture, and we'll explain how. I'm not saying stupas were the background, but yes, the idea of having a stupa in the longer run can be looked as something which was giving birth to a temple architecture in the later periods. With the coming of the Gupta age, we find that temple complexes were built in a larger manner, on a larger scale, and most of these artistic activities of this period are termed as religious art by the scholars. We find predominantly Brahmanic structures were built. And the major centers of Gupta art and sculpture can be known as Sarnath, can be talked of as Sarnath school, Mathura and Nalanda. Here one thing is quite interesting. The first artistic activities in Indian subcontinent were predominantly associated with Buddhism. In fact, the first statues to be built were of Buddha. And if we remember, then Mathura and Gandhar school of art, which flourished under Kushan rule, they were the first ones to make statues of Buddha. From there, these later traditions develop. And after Mathura and Gandhar, we find Sarnath emerges as another school of art. Then during Satvahan period, we have Amravati as a famous school of art. Now, all these schools of art, all their ideas finally culminate into different art forms. And then even Brahmanic concepts enter into these schools, and we find statues of Vishnu being made. Then Gupta period architecture, we find that brick structures, simple roofed stone structures being built, and these are termed as given different names as temples. Then we find certain rock cut caves are there, for example the Udayagiri cave. In this slide again I have shown the great Varaha image. It is at the entrance of this cave. Now Udayagiri cave is associated with Gupta Emperor Chandragupta. One interesting fact here, the idea of having a cave architecture is actively associated with Buddhism, but in this case, it is now being associated with a Brahmanic religious idea, and Varaha has been shown. Now, why Varaha iconography gets popularized in this period can again be associated with the contemporary political scenario. Varaha's incarnation or the boar incarnation of Vishnu is associated with protection concept. That Vishnu protects the earth in the same way Gupta kings tried to protect the realm of the period. Now, as we proceed further, we can look into the structural styles. The Panchayatan temple style develops with the Gupta period. Panch means five and ayat means a square. A square generally has four corners, but this Panchayatan style has got four corners and a central deity in between. This idea develops further. And we find that there are five major types of temples in this period. We have flat-roofed square temple. Then we have flat-roofed square temple with a second story known as Viman. And then we have a square temple with a curvy linear top or a shikhar. We have a rectangular temple and then a circular temple. Now with these five basic temple styles which develop from Gupta period, we find later period Nagar, Dravid and Vaisar styles getting developed. In the slides, we can see the pictures of Devgarh temple. It's a brick-built temple. Then Vishnu iconography at Devgarh, the Kankali Devi temple, then Parvati temple, you can see the flat roof structures here. Then Sanchi temple, and then Sarnath sculpture and architecture, where we look at Dhamek and Chaukhandi stup, how the transformation of the space comes into existence and how temple architecture can be connected to the earlier stupa architecture. Now, the last slide speaks of towards the early medieval, how the earlier temple building styles culminated into later period architectural styles, and this is something we'll be discussing in the next part of our lecture. Now, in the second part of the lecture, we look at temples as structures of Brahmanical religion in early India. When we talk of temples as structures, we are emphasizing that how these structures came into existence and how they got transformed over a period of time. Now, if you remember in the previous lecture, I discussed that how the concept of sacred groves or how the Bronze Age ideas or how even Neolithic mother goddess cult shrines developed into temple-like structures. And I gave examples of different Jyotirlings and then Shakti Peets. In this part of the lecture, we'll discuss how this site of temple got transformed into a structure and what changes were inherent in it. So we would be emphasizing more on the major architectural styles, what were the background of these styles, what were the reasons, and why we have regional styles and why also we have sub-regional styles. So it has to do more with the post-Gupta period. So let's proceed further with our discussion. As we had discussed in the last part of the previous lecture, the Panchayatan style of Gupta period developed into three major regional styles known as Nagar style, prevalent in the northern parts of Indian subcontinent. Then we have Dravid style, prevalent in the southern parts of Indian subcontinent. And then Vesara style, prevalent or very popular in the peninsular parts. If we talk of this geographical distinction, we find that there was an overlapping of time and space concept. The border areas or the adjoining areas had an overlap. And in fact, the Vesara style is a complete overlap of Nagar and Dravid style. It's known as a fusion or a combination of both the styles. Nagar style was prevalent in the land to the north of Vindhyas, and Dravid style was popular beyond Krishna, between Krishna and Kaveri rivers. In the same manner, Vesara was popular in the peninsular parts. Now, let's proceed further with this discussion. In this slide, I'm looking into the Nagar style of temple architecture. Here we can look at the layout of the typical temple. We can look at the shikhar, that is the spire, then the half spire, and then we have a great platform on which this entire temple structure rests peacefully or comfortably. We have got kalash on top of every shikhar, entrance steps, etc., lots of mandap, entrance halls and all, circumambulatory passage. Now, I would suggest if you compare this style with the previous Gupta period temple architectural styles, or the images which we had seen in the previous lecture, for example, the Sanchi temple, we find a great scale transformation coming up. Lots of technologies have been used, lots of changes come up. Here, this is what Arish Sharma emphasizes, that this shows that there were changes coming up in the socio-politics of the period. Professor Sharma says, or Professor Sharma emphasizes, that these temple structures of early medieval period represent that polities were transforming in this period. Now, that's another debate. Instead of going into that debate, we can just shorten up that discussion here, that the structures of this period, they reflect that kingship was transforming itself. The idea of king, or the idea of having an elaborate royal title concept, which are known as epithets, could actually be reflected through these grandiose temple architectures. Then we find that this idea is a typical idea of the Khajuraho school, or known as the Central Indian Temple Architecture. This idea transforms itself into other minor styles, but more or less the picture remains the same. The Shikhar concept is a representation of the Mount Meru concept. Mount Meru is a famous concept in Indian iconography. It's a hill which is mentioned as the highest mountain range in Indian mythology. So the Shikhar more or less is a representation of that. When we talk of main features of the Nagar style, we find that there is a prominent pinnacle or a shikhar which represents Mount Meru. Then there is a pillared entrance hall, assembly hall, covered ambulatory passage, inner sanctum sanctorium, which is known as Garbhgri, where the deity statue is placed, and then pradakshina, or like circumambulation, could be done around the Garbhgri. This idea of doing pradakshina was popular in the stupa architecture as well, where people could go round that stupa. If you remember the stupa image which we saw in the previous lecture, that pradakshina path has been emphasized. Similarly, Sanchi stupa has a nice place where you can do pradakshina. You can go round. You would have seen these practices even today in temples. For example, if you look at that Shiv temples, where Shivling is placed in the center and we have four deities in a small chamber-like structure and people go round it. So that idea can be connected to the Gupta period Panchayatan style and then upper developments over there to the later period Nagar style. So this is how we say that change and continuities are part and parcel of a historical study. Then as far as other features are concerned, we have a raised platform, and the entire temple has been planned on a raised platform structure. The plan may be square or rectangle. then there is an absence of tanks in these temples. This has been explained that most of the Naga temples were in areas where perennial rivers were there. So the idea of having a tank to collect water would not have been very popular with the society. Top roof is normally divided vertically into 3, 5, 7 or 9, and these are known as Trirath, Panchrath, Saptarath and Navrath respectively. Then there are three sub-schools of the Nagar school of temple architecture. These sub-schools are Khajuraho school in central India. It got popularized under the Chandela dynasty. Then the Odisha school in Odisha. This got popularized under the Gajpati Suryavanshi kings. And then the Solanki school in Rajasthan under the Chaulukyas or the Solanki rulers. Besides these major sub-schools, some scholars also talk of three minor sub-schools. For example, the hilly areas where temples were built of metal and wood and they have a nice conical spire. It's the same Nagar style shikhar, but it is built according to the contemporary or according to the requirements of geographical features of these areas. Keeping in mind the heavy snowfall or rainfall, we have got different ideas of the shikhar. You can compare the shikhar of Pashupati temple here and check how transformation happens within Nagar style itself. Then besides that, some scholars talk of Bengal school of architecture where terracotta has been used for decoration and sculpture, and then even Parmar school of architecture. So these three are mentioned as minor schools, but the major ones remain Khajuraho, Odisha and the Solanki school. Now we proceed further to the specific characteristic features of these sub-schools as well. First, the Khajuraho school. This developed under the patronage of the Chandela rulers of Jajag Bhukti in present-day Bundelkhand region. Time period is early medieval period, that is 10th to 12th century CE. Basic elements are the same features of Nagar style, that is a shikhar, garbhgri and a pillared portico. Both interior and exterior walls are lavishly decorated with intricate carvings. And as already discussed in the previous lecture, these carvings are drawn heavily from the Kama Sutra traditions of Vatsyayana. Then the platform is relatively high. Famous examples of Khajuraho schools are Kandariya Mahadev temple, Lakshman temple, etc. Sculptures are based on erotic themes. Same complex has several temples and there are no boundary walls. Tradition mentions that more than 27 temples could be found at the site of Khajuraho. The main shikhar along with many minor shikhars gives the impression of a mountain range. Second is the Odisha school. Main features of the Odisha school is that it developed under the patronage of Gajpati kings in Odisha. Time period is same 10th to 12th century CE. The raw material is locally available stone. Now if you see that the time period remains the same, but still there are certain variations. So the larger picture is of a Nagar style. But within Nagar style, we find some minor deviations. That's why we say that these are different schools of temple architecture. Then exterior walls are lavishly decorated with intricate carvings, while the interior walls are plain. Here in Odisha school, we find that instead of pillars, iron girders are used to support the roof. These iron girders could be seen easily in the Jagannath temple complex. And it's same like iron can be compared to the Mehrauli iron pillar. So thus we can say that the idea of metallurgy was also quite developed in these periods. Then the shikhar in Odisha temple is known as Deul. And it is almost vertical till the top and then it suddenly curves slightly inwards. The examples are Sun Temple of Konark. It's also known as Black Pagoda as black stone was used to make it and dated around 1300 CE. Then we have Jagannath Puri at CE, dated around 1100 CE. In this slide, you can see the image of Jagannath Temple. And you can see the shikhar and then like the pyramidal shikhars as well. Can compare it with the Nagar style. And then the idea of Rekha Devula has been explained in this slide. You can see how the shikhar curves inwards, and then you can see the three main styles: Rekha Devula, Pidha Devula, and then Khakra Devula. Now we talk of the Solanki school. The Solanki school is also known as Rajasthan Gujarat school of architecture. It's also known as Jain school of architecture and also as Chaulukya school of architecture based on the dynasty which was patronizing it. It developed under the patronage of the Solanki or Chaulukya rulers of Gujarat. Time period is 10th to 12th century CE, same as the other two schools. Raw material is locally available marble and the walls of the central shrine, we are talking of the Modhera temple here. It's a famous sun temple. It's purposely devoid of carvings and it's left plain as the temple faces east. And every year at the time of the equinoxes, we find that the sun shines directly into this central shrine. Now, this feature is exclusive of the sun temple at Modhera. So, we find that sunlight has been tapped in using that technology. Now, it's not a rocket science. It's simple physics, optic physics, which people of the ancient period have incorporated into temple building activities. Then, massive rectangular step tanks could be found in these temples. These are known as step wells or the bavlis. Interestingly, on each and every step, we find a small deity or a shrine-like thing placed. This has something to do with hygiene of the people. Now, this idea of having a deity on every step would be that people would not litter around, people should not dirty those steps because that water was used for many purposes, drinking, cleaning, bathing and large scale activities. This is what a historian's understanding says, that why there were shrines on every step of that step well. Then this idea of having a step well is also very interesting. It shows that the concept of technology is directly proportional to the geographical features of a region. In areas where groundwater is at a lower level, people use technology of having a step well to tap that groundwater. Otherwise, they can make a tank for rainwater harvesting. But as we are aware, the western parts, particularly Gujarat, Rajasthan, has very little amount of rainfall. So, there is no case of tapping that rainwater. Now, unfortunately, in present times, due to global warming and all, we have got erratic behavior of even rainfall and monsoon winds. But in those times, it was more or less a very barren-like area. So, they have come up with a technology of having a step well so that they can tap this groundwater and then they can use it for different purposes. Then they can collect that rainwater as well in the same structures. Then the famous examples of Solanki school are the Dilwara Jain temples at Mount Abu. This is something which we should discuss in detail. The Jain temples at Mount Abu are dedicated to the Jain deities and they were patronized by Vastupal and Tejpal. These were two Jain ministers of contemporary Solanki ruler, and these ministers got the Nagar style of architecture fused into Jain iconography, and the outcome is quite beautiful. We find white marble structures are there, and interestingly, they are devoid of erotic sculptures. Now, why am I emphasizing on erotic sculptures? Because in the same period, in the same temple building architectural style, in the Khajuraho school, we find large scale use of erotics. In the same manner, in the Konark temple of the Odisha school, again erotic sculptures are profound. But in the same period, using the same style in Gujarat, Rajasthan, erotic sculptures are almost negligible. This needs an explanation. And the explanation is that since these temples are being dedicated to Jain Tirthankaras, and if we are aware, then Jainism, one basic feature of Jainism was that Brahmacharya should be adopted. So, I feel that was the reason why they are avoiding erotic sculptures. Otherwise, it has to do nothing with the morality or immorality of the society. As already emphasized, that ancient people had a different norm. They were not like our norms. In fact, our 21st century norms would be at odds to what ancient people thought and believed. Then in this slide, you can see the famous Jain temple. This is the roof, the Dilwara Jain temple, and the pillars of the Dilwara temple. You can see exquisite carving has been done. There is no dearth of technology in carving and sculpture, but still eroticism is weak. Then you can see the pillared halls. You can see deities and different statues being built. Interestingly, you can see the Toran or the Bandhanwar tradition as well in these between two temples. Then we move on to the Dravid style of temple architecture. This style developed under the patronage of Pallava dynasty and continued to flourish under the Chola dynasties. There were four stages and in the course of its development. Under the Pallavas, there were four styles: Mahindra group, Narsimha group, Rajasimha and then Nandivarman group. These styles are based on the features of the temples and they are named according to the king who was on throne. Then when we talk of Mahindra group, this group of temple architecture was highly influenced by the earlier cave architecture. And the famous examples are the rock cut temples at Bhairav Konda and Ananteshwar temple at Undavali. Then the Narsimha group includes several rathas or small monolithic temples which were carved or hewn out of single rock boulder. Famous of these are the Rath temples at Mamallapuram or Mahabalipuram. Then Rajasimha group mentioned includes 6 famous temples, at 3 at Mahabalipuram, including the Shore temple, and the other like Kailashnath temple at Kanchi. The Nandivarman group is quite interesting because several small temples were built without any distinct feature, and historians connect it to the political turmoils which were happening during the rule of this Pallav ruler. And examples are Mukteshwar and Matangeshwar temples at Kanchi. When we move on to the Chola period, then we find that the temple building activities increase and large freestanding temple structures are built. Popular amongst them are the Chidambaram temples, Rameshwaram, Kumbakonam, Lipakshi, Brihadishwar and Rajarajeshwar temple. The Chola period temples have been actively and very directly connected to the Chola period imperial policy or the extension of state and society. How royalty perceived itself could easily be connected to the ideas and iconography as well as architecture of the Brihadishwar and Rajarajeshwar temples. Cholas had a capital city, Gangaikond Cholpuram. And if we go into the political history of that period, we find that this temple iconography can directly be connected to the political developments which were happening in those days. Now, in this slide, we can see the images of the Shore temple at Mahabalipuram and then the Rathas. You can easily make out that how boulders on the seashore were cut into these temple structures, and you can see changes in the iconography. Then this is a famous sculpture of Pallav period. It is known as Descent of the Ganga or also known as Arjuna's Penance. In this image, you can see that how rock surface has been used for iconography and how there is a small temple towards the lower end where you can see the Dravidian architecture being mentioned very nicely. Then in this next slide, we can look into the Dravidian style. This is particular of the Brihadishwar temple under the Chola period. You can see that Garbhagriha style is just like Nagar style. Basic distinction comes up in the Viman and then in the Shikhar. The Shikhar or the spire of the Dravidian temples is more like a pyramid. It's not as pointed as the Shikhar of North Indian style. They have large number of pillared halls which were used for different purposes, meetings, etc. Then this is the Gopuram. This Gopuram is known as a gateway or an entrance. Most of the times these Gopurams were built when the king visited the temple or when the king achieved some famous victory or something like that. Then we come to the third style known as the Vesar style. This is known as the fusion of the Nagar and the Dravidian style. The first phase is found at Ehole and Vadapi or Badami under the Chalukyas of the peninsular parts. Chalukyas were a dynasty which was ruling in present-day Karnataka region. Interestingly, this style can be connected to Rashtrakoots as well. Rashtrakoots were a dynasty which ruled after the Guptas in the peninsular parts, present-day Maharashtra, Karnataka region. And among these, Rashtrakoots got several temples built in Ellora area. The rock surfaces were carved, hewn out, and temples structures were built out. So we have tried to connect this as the precursor to the Vesara style of temples. So after that, we find that under Chalukyas, Ehole, Badami, and Pattadakal emerge as three great centers for Vesara style of temple architecture. At Ehole, we have a famous temple known as Lal Khan temple. Similarly, towards the early medieval period, we find a famous mosque known as Atala Devi Masjid in Jaunpur. Now, Jaunpur is in northern India in Gangetic Valley. It falls into the Gahadwal domain. The Nagar style of temple would have been here, but the names are quite interesting. On one hand, we have Atala Devi Mosque, and on the other hand, we have Lal Khan Temple. So, I hope this is how you can connect historical realities and then reach to conclusions on your own. Then we have a famous Durga temple. This Durga temple is not dedicated to Durga but to Vishnu. But since it was placed in a fort complex, that's why it's known as Durga. Durga means a fort. Then we have other temples, then Vatapi temples. And then the second phase of Chalukya temple architecture can be found at Pattadakal. At Pattadakal, we find 10 temples, out of which 4 are in Nagar style and 6 are in Dravidian style. Then we have Papnath temple in Nagar style, Virupaksh temple in Dravidian style, and then Sangameshwar temple in Dravidian style. In these slides, you can see the Rashtrakoot phase of Kailash temple, Ellora. Interestingly, this is a single boulder, rock boulder. It has been hewn, carved, and then intricate carvings has been done to give it the structure of a temple. Then we come in the same Vesar style, we find that after Chalukyas, there were other dynasties which were also involved. For example, the Hoysalas, the Kakatiyas, and even the Vijayanagar kings. So when we talk of Hoysala dynasty, since Helibid was their capital, we find that the famous Hoysaleshwar temple was built there. It's built on a star-shaped platform. Roof is not that high. It's slightly pyramidal. But then these dynasties provided distinct identities to Vesar style. Vesar style reached its highest pinnacle of growth and development under the Vijayanagar kings, who added certain features like Amman shrine and then elaborate Gopurams. So we'll be discussing these in the coming slides. First, the Hoysala dynasty. Star-shaped platforms become prominent under this dynasty, and the temples have highly ornamented porches. Shikhars are not very high, and minute carvings could be found. Famous temples like Somnathpur temple, Belur, and Helibid temples. In this slide, you can see the Lard Khan temple. It was known as Lard Khan because a famous political personality known as Lard Khan came to occupy this place, but he allowed the people to come and do veneration and rituals inside the temple complex. But as tradition passed on, the name Lard Khan continued to exist. You can see how the roof is like a wooden structure, but though it is made of stone. Then the Pattadakal temples, you can see in these slides. Then under the Vijayanagar kings, as already mentioned, the architecture involved lots of intricacies, lots of development. And one interesting thing, the secular buildings of Vijayanagar period could be shown as using Indo-Islamic architecture, for example, dome and arches. You have a slide here where you can see the elephant's tables where domes could be seen. Now, these are not perfect domes, but still they are dome-like structures. So, we are saying fusion happens in these architectural styles. Major elements of the temples under Vijayanagar include impressive gopurams, Kalyan mandapams, which were halls meant for ritual purposes, for example, marriage of the deity, Garbhgrih, that this inner sanctum sanctorium for the chief deity, and then Amman shrine. Amman shrine was a new feature added by the Vijayanagar kings, and this small shrine was used like a Garbhgrih for the wife of the chief deity. This is something quite interesting in this phase. Then the use of pillars increases, and horse is the most important motif to be found on most of the temple surfaces. Secular buildings, as already mentioned, they have Indo-Islamic features. And major examples, you can find Hampi temples. The ruins at Hampi are the marvelous examples of this period. Famous temples are the Hazara Swami temple, also known as Hazara Ram Swami temple, the Krishna Swami temple, the Vithal Swami temple, the Parvati temple at Chidambaram, the Talkanteshwar temple at Vellore, the Varadraj and Ekambarnath temples at Kanchipuram. And then even Krishnadev Rai got a famous city known as Nagalpur built in honor and memory of his mother Nagamba. Then in this slide you can see the Virupaksh temple and its Gopuram. Sometimes Gopuram, the gateway was higher than the main shrine itself. Then you can see the Hampi ruins. You can see how naturally occurring stone boulders were used for making pillars, roofs and different styles. Here you can see the technology, how beam and pillars have been used in a very simple manner. You can see the Ratha architecture here in this slide, then Hazar Ram Swami temple. And I was talking of these elephant stables where you can see on top certain dome-like structures. And then we reach to the conclusion. In the conclusion, we can say that temples were not only sacred spaces but also had many social roles to play. They were symbols of political authority, they were agents of legitimacy, they were agents of cultural repositories. They were promoters of culture like dance, music, etc. They served as agents for upward social mobility. They were agents of cult syncretization. And they marked the extension of epic Puranic ideas. These were symbols of artistic and technological improvements. And interestingly, temples of Jagannath or temples of Vindhyavasini or temples of different tribal deities, they can actually be mentioned as marking the stage when the Brahmanic religion expanded and included the autochthonous or the tribal ideas into its fold. And that's why we find these deviations also entering into the mainstream of a religious idea. Then we have provided a detailed reading list for the help of our students. Thank you.
Dear friends, on that note, we would like to thank Mr. Kumar for coming to our show and delivering this wonderful lecture. And thank you, dear friends, for watching our show. Stay tuned and keep watching. Thank you.